Reggae Uprising with your host, Danielle.
Greetings, Reggae Uprising podcast family, and welcome to another episode. If you are fresh and new to Reggae Uprising podcast, it is all about connecting people of the African diaspora through wisdom, overstanding, inspirational stories, all backed by a soundtrack of sweet reggae music. Now, each and every Wednesday, I feature a new guest, and they're all from different walks of life, different industries, different talents that they hold, but they share their experiences for the collective upliftment of all of us. Now, each guest picks 7 reggae selections that inspire them, that they share memories with, maybe they uplifted them, and they serve as a soundtrack, like I said earlier, for their interview. Now, if you want to get caught up on any previous episodes, all you need to do is go to danielle.co.uk. The link is in the description, where you can also find my other weekly show, Reggae Uprising, which is me, as well as being your host. I am also a reggae singer-songwriter. So each and every Monday, I do a reggae song, whether it be a cover song, whether it be an original version of one of my songs, at the start of your week to just uplift you and get you in the right vibration. So like I said, if you want to check those out, all you need to do is go to danielle.co.uk, where actually you can also find my original works as well. So you can find my original music videos, original tracks, and obviously here in the UK, when live music gets going again, you'll also be able to find my shows so that you can find me live. Now, we've got all of that out of the way. We're going to get started with today's guest's first selection, which is Rastaman Live Up, Bob Marley.
Rastaman Live Up. Bongo man, don't give up. Congo man, live up. Bingi man, don't give up.
Guest is a dub poet, author, philosopher, social advocate, and reggae artiste. He is creator of Poetry in Motion, the longest running and most successful poetry festival in Jamaican history, as well as Pomedy Show, Jamaica Poetry Festival, and Senyacum Edutainment promotion. I would like to welcome Yasus Afari. Greetings and welcome, Yasus.
Yes, greetings and thanks for having me. It's always good to change thoughts for the benefit of our listeners and the wider humanity. So I'm honored.
Well, you're most welcome. Can you tell us the reason for that first selection that we just heard?
Well, we think that, you know, energy flows where attention goes, and it's always good to accentuate the positive. And certainly, when that song was released, and even up to this day, continues to be relevant exhortation for the Rastafarian community, and by extension for the human community, to live up, to be positive, to keep your head up, to fulfill your purpose in life, and to keep a positive attitude. And so that's a kind of general reason. But for a personal reason, the time in which that song was really in vogue was when I was at college, at College of Arts, Science and Technology. It was at the time. It is now called University of Technology. And I found that song to have been very inspirational, very motivational, both as a human being and as a youth who was emerging in Rastafari faith. So it has a sustained resonance in terms of its positive inspiration and impact on me personally and people who interacted with it then and still do now when it is being played.
Okay, and as I ask all of my guests here on Reggae Uprising podcast, as it's all about connecting people of the African diaspora, can you tell us more about your heritage?
Right, well, obviously, you know, his mama Africa gave birth to the human family. She's the cradle and womb of humanity and civilization. And as nations rise and nations fall, Mama Africa was required to be the human fertilizer. So Europe and by extension America kind of gang raped Mama Africa and reduced her children to chattel slaves. So we were not slaves, but we were enslaved. And so we are part of the transatlantic triangle of debt and genocide and decay, which brought enslaved Africans into Jamaica as a transshipment point for the enslaved and for the goods that were manufactured and sent back to Europe and the other colonial outposts. So, you know, over time, this started pretty much in 1492, then 1494, up to 1655 when the British snatched Jamaica from the Spaniards. And so we struggled through the different waves of the struggle until we are now 55 years independent while still independancing, waiting for the total and conclusive liberation and redemption, reparation and repatriation of us as a people who have been, of which Africa has been and continue to be dispossessed based on the current neocolonial construction. However, I was born in the 60s and I went to Rosehall Basic All Age Junction Secondary, now BB Co Comprehensive High School, from which I won a scholarship to the St. Elizabeth Technical High School, where I wrote my very first poem in the 70s entitled The Traveling Son. I was born really in a rural district called Hamilton Town in South St. Elizabeth. And, you know, our people were supposedly impoverished to the point where we did not have a clock, a watch, a telephone, radio, no running water, no appliances in the home. And so we were challenged at night to turn around, make fashion, as this law would say. So we would put piniwale, what people maybe call firefly, inside a bottle, use it as a torch at night. So that was kind of a resonance that vibrated when I was asked to write a poem. And so my poem was The Traveling Sun, because the sun was a reliable source of light for us in those circumstances. And the teacher, Mrs. Olga McDonald, she read it to the class and said, "This is a very good poem. You must continue writing." So right then and there, I was a beneficiary of positive reinforcement, which is similar to what your program aspires to do. And so up to this day, I still hear that positive reinforcement ringing in my ears. You must continue writing. And if you're not right or wrong, so we're happy to continue writing. So that's pretty much the genesis of my poetic journey. From St. Elizabeth Technical High School, I went to work with telephone company, continued writing there, publishing Jamaica Lines and in the daily newspapers and so on. From there, I got a scholarship, as I alluded to earlier, to the College of Arts, Science and Technology, now called University of Technology. I continued writing there, and I was responsible for social and cultural activities on campus. One of those responsibilities resulted in me organizing a fundraiser for the Commerce Department, and I performed on that event, and the response and the feeling was so good that I decided this seems to me to be my career choice moving through life, in spite of the engineering that I was studying at CAST at the time.
Okay. You're jumping ahead. I wanna take it back. I wanna reel it back a little bit. So you gave us an insight into your childhood. What was it like growing up in Jamaica, and who were your role models when you were little? Who inspired you?
Right. What was it like growing up in Jamaica? And we just want to add in rural, deep rural Jamaica. It's a farming community. My mother was a hidler. So she bought vegetable and foodstuff from the farmers. She did a little farming herself, from the extended family as well, and traveled from St. Elizabeth to St. James to sell in the market. So that kind of gave you a framework as to what that was, growing up on a farm without electricity and the herbs. But we were happy, and we would, you know, go to the parish tank for water. We go to the bush to find firewood to cook the food. We didn't have electric or gas stove or anything like that. And so that was, you know, we would hunt for the birds, we shoot them for meat, unfortunately. And we'll take the young ones from out the nest and rear them until they are big. And you know, that was kind of, you know, how things were in those days. In terms of role models now, obviously your mother, one of my popular early poems is My Mother Who Fathered Me. I'm pretty much a single parent boy. And so my mother was the first role model. Growing up over time though, like, you know, people from school and then later on the African Liberation Movement, Marcus Garvey obviously was an early one. And subsequent to that, quite a few others from the reggae Rastafari cultural community, both in Jamaica, the Caribbean, and further afield. But beyond the early growing up period, though, when we were going to States again, I would have traveled 6 miles to take a school bus to go to Santa Cruz, which is quite a little distance from Southeast St. Elizabeth, where I'm from. And you know, that helped kind of mold who we were at the time and who we are now. When one of the early days, though, I must have been about 10, 11, I remember distinctly that rock is now called Chanting Rock. I used to come from school and they would tie up Milo tin and all the, you know, all the tin cans in a tree, and I would use a stick and play music with them. Percussive music with them, and then I would chant and sing and preach. I remember a cousin of mine called Andrea Clark. She's now living in Barbados, by the way. We call her Dibs affectionately. She would join us and kind of do me like a backup like. And that was kind of something which the community grew up on and has as a point of reference for me then and even up to now.
Okay, we're going to move on to your next selection, which is Pablo Mose's A Song. Why did you choose this selection?
Again, Pablo Mose's, no. When I kind of started visiting Kingston, living in Kingston, this was Vineyard Town. And he was friends with one of my sisters, Jasmine, as well as my brother, we call him Afro. And so we knew Pablo Moses from in the early, you know, late 70s and so on. And then when I was at college, we used to visit him, became friends now. And he was one of my early inspiration and teachers in terms of business. And we would reason on Rastafari, reason on reggae music, reason music, and African liberation struggle. That song now has a sort of gumption, a resonance, a magnetism, in terms of his melody, in terms of his tone, in terms of the message in the song. And we know that, you know, one song, one thought, one word, one deed can be a catalyst for change. And that song in particular was and continued to be a catalyst of change for myself and for others. So it is an honor to select a Pablo Moses song, and specifically a song.
Here we go with Pablo Moses, a song.
At night, when others are in bed, strong meditations get to my head. With a guitar under my favorite tree, and your inspiration building in me. I play and play and sing and sing, releasing the inspiration within and reaching them. A song, yeah, for everyone. A song, your song.
Can you tell us of, this might be hard to pin down, I don't know, maybe it's easy, three moments in your childhood that kind of stick with you as like either pivotal moments or just moments that you really enjoyed, or maybe places that you loved going as a child, or a specific experience that stands out to you from your childhood?
Yes, I think there are quite a few. If I had to go three, the first one that comes readily to mind would have been, there was a dog called Napoleon Bonaparte, a Bonaparte, I think they called it, and it was passing my home at the time, very rural, and that, you know, dog would bark as usual, and I got scared and ran, and then the dog ran after me. And I fell in a pit, and the root of a, I don't remember if it were a naseberry or a guinea tree, ran straight through my bottom lip. I still have that scar, I just felt it a while ago. And I won't pray that thing too much, but however, it was the first of three accidents that happened in my life, which I dub three operational accidents. They were quite not accidents, they were maybe synchronistic in terms of formulating my metaphysical and biometaphysical reality. So that was the first one, and that might have been when I was about 10 or thereabout. That's a very outstanding one. And then there was another incident of which me and my foster brother, Carl Hilton, we were singing or trying to sing. And there was somebody who was passing and recommended that if we want to have a good singing voice, we should drink skelly and tea. This kind of stayed with me, even though I didn't try it. However, interestingly, while I was at college in the 80s, that memory came back. How when in a Rastafari state of mind, especially in its emergence, you'd have reflected on the history to have it inform your future, like the Sankofa approach. And so I reflected on that particular experience, which somehow stayed with me. And I started drinking skelly and tea. And that very summer, I started chanting poetry, which you call dub poetry, with a certain special tone and signature, which describes my art. So that was kind of pivotal in terms of that experience. And that's why maybe I continue to remember that. Another early experience, though, very early as well, would have been the first time we heard a radio being played, and remember distinctly taking off the back of the radio, trying to find the person inside talking. So those are some of the impressionable memories.
And can you remember from your childhood maybe phrases that were used by maybe your mum or maybe the other elders that at the time you're like, I don't really understand what they mean when they say that? Or maybe you did have an understanding, but then as you've got older, it's kind of evolved and kept evolving. Are there any like phrases or, you know, any old sayings that kind of stick with you now?
I guess maybe keep by your mouth, because that was quite awful. At that time, the thing was for children to be seen and not necessarily heard. Not that we subscribe to that, really. We advocate for discipline and respect for both parents and children. And we like to advocate that the children have a voice, just like the adults have a voice, and must be listened to and respected, so that the family can practice consensus building through family consultation. Hopefully that can extend into consensus building through community consultation, both for national, regional, and international development. So Kibayomo would have been one. But one particular one, maybe not so much a phrase, but a saying, speak the truth and speak it ever. Cost it what it will. He who hides the wrong he does the wrong thing still. Mother used to drill that inside our head, especially to ensure that we keep it honest. And so that is one that would have lived with me over time. Maybe another for the tree would be speaking of the sky falling at your eye. Well, we maybe never fully grip it very, very young, but evidently, as we continue our development and even up to now, you see, you know, where it is overstood from even the Kemetic experience. I am because we are, so above, so below, so within, so without, that which was is that which is and that it is to be. And so what you sow is what you reap. And karma as well comes back to bring your efforts and intention into your own reality. So do you have it?
We're going to move on to your next selection, which is Truth and Right, Johnny Osborne. Can you tell us about this selection and why you chose it?
Yeah, well, I'm going to make that one a simple one. Johnny Osborne is kind of, depends on where you sit, where you are, might be someone who not really getting full recognition for his brilliance and talent. And that particular song right there epitomizes that very notion. So it's a song that, I don't know what to say, it's like it grab you, it sink deep inside of your bone marrow. It's like the message, the vibe, the melody, the timing of that song, Truth and Rights. You know, I mean, the truths that set us free, where people, as African people in the diaspora, are struggling for full freedom and liberation and reparation, repatriation, certainly from the Safari perspective. And truth and rights, you know, is the penultimate noble objective and vision and methodology in that process. And so it's one of my favorite songs, actually, and certainly one of my favorite reggae songs. And it's a beautiful voice, a beautiful message. And so we take the opportunity to share it with your listeners.
Here we go with Johnny Osborne, Truth and Rights.
Render your heart and not your garments. The truth is there for who have eyes to see. Partiality has no place in this judgment. Remember the words of prophecy. Children, run, come to truths and rights. That's what I'm about. Know the truths and rights. Teach it to the children. You know the truths and rights. Teach it to the children, 'cause they should know. No, 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 no. Children, say a little prayer every night before you go to sleep.
cause tomorrow is promised to no one. When you think it's peace and safety, Lord, it could be sudden destruction. Cause we know, yes, we know.
Now, you touched on your writing. I want to talk a little bit more about this. Let us know, give us an insight. What's your writing process? How long does it take? Is it in short spurts, or do you write masses and masses in one go? How does it come to you?
There's no uniformity, you know, where that is concerned. For example, I've had spurts where I'd write up to 30 odd poems in one flow, maybe taking me 24 hours or more. So that's one. You have pieces that you write almost instantaneously. Sometimes you don't even write it, you memorize it until if and when you write it. So that's another approach. And so you do have pieces that you start writing and you revisit, or maybe continue revisiting for years and decades. And so it really varies, because you see, what I think about poetry, you know, poetry really, for me really, is like the original genetic memory codes were embedded in poetic codes. And so I think us as poets are really reflecting and mirroring retentive memory. And so the inspiration comes when the circumstances necessitate. For example, you bury a seed in the soil, and it can be there for years upon years until if and when those conditions are right. Moisture, sun, whatever else. You maybe need to be transported by an animal or something or somebody from one point to the next to get it to those environmental conditions that are conducive to its birth or rebirth or its emergence from that latent state. And so similarly, I would think that these embedded genetic poetic memory codes that have been in our psyche and in our genes from times immemorial would have come into being and be quickened when the circumstances are right. And so we can't really measure or predict those quite effectively. And then I'm kind of an intuitive, really. So I can construct a poem just like I could teach someone, or try to teach someone to write a poem. And there are methodologies that I employ. I do that quite a lot across the world. And so I could be my own student in that respect. Certainly not one of my favorite methods. So I would like to wait on the inspiration if and when it comes. And I like to be a prepared instrument and vessel to record that retentive memory.
So can you tell us more about your written works in terms of your books? The different works that you've produced, and yeah, tell us more about them so people can find them and read them.
Oh, brilliant. Thanks for that. my first anthology, published anthology really, is called I Pen. And my mother, who fathered me, is in that anthology as well. And it is actually livicated, not dedicated, certainly not. Is dedicated to my mother who fathered me. And the title came from a poem which I wrote in the 80s and which inspired Garnet Silk, interestingly, and which we recorded together. Many people know I Can See Clearly, which we did with Garnet Silk. However, I Pen is one, as well as People Dancing. And so I Pen, yeah, is the title for that anthology, which inspired the book in the first place, and which inspired Silk and many others. So that anthology came out in 1999, and it was reissued in 2008, I think, and it did pretty well and continued to do well. It's kind of more philosophical reasoning and poetry. And so so that's the first. The second, though, is really not poetry, but it was inspired by my poetic works. In the late 90s, I wrote a proposal to the Ministry of Education, Youth and Culture, Senator Bertrand Whiteman. at the time. That's what the Ministry of Education was designated then. It has a different designation now. However, he invited me to the ministry to have some discussions, which led to Jamaica's first culture agency program, as well as the Jamaica Day celebration, as well as the government policy document on culture and education, cultural tourism, and cultural entrepreneurship, of which I played a significant role in all of those. And so when I went into the schools now as a culture agent, and by then the Caribbean Council Examination, CXC, they had been studying Rastafari as a cultural and indigenous social and religious expression of the Caribbean. But most of the resource people and resource material, the resource people were not Rastafari in the name. The resource material were not written by Rastafari, and sometimes were not written by people who were sensitive and respectful for the Rastafari ideology and philosophy and theology and liberty. And so I saw it as a responsibility of mine, and we took 5 years and wrote the book, which became a national bestseller and continues to do exceptionally well. It is called Overstanding Rastafari, Jamaica's Gift to the World. And I have news for you. The Oxford University has been using that book as a resource material, and me to some extent as a resource person, for a series of religious studies book that they have been doing for the Caribbean. And so that is just one of the examples of how that book continued to be impactful. My third publication is called Vocal Ink, The Mental Intercourse. And so I have several stuff working on now. My new anthology should have been out last year, but we wanted to wait out the pandemic. And we wanted to, you know, have book signing and launches the old-fashioned way. And so we kind of seen wanting to see how that goes before we determine when that will be published. But in between time, now I do publish for other people, the first of which is Making Kenke from Memory, which was written by Kabu Mahat-Keru of RFM and Running African Fame. She's really a very stalwart Pan-Africanist in Jamaica and the Pan-African community globally. And so that particular book, Making Kenke from Memory, speaks to the Sankofering, the Sankofic journey, which is quite applicable in our circumstances. And so I was happy to play a part in that publication through Senyacum Publishing.
We're going to move on to your next selection, which is Never Gonna Give Ja Up by Sugar Miner. Why did you choose this one?
Well, I mean, the one is kind of obvious, but since it's not that obvious, may I make it obvious? Because we believe no retreat, no surrender. And you know, we just want to keep sticking to the task, keep focused before them costs. So we don't want to buy into the mass destruction, which the destructive media is very adept at. And so we just want to keep that positive reinforcement. Never, ever give up. Never give Jah up. Jah is our source and our inspiration. And Jah helped to keep us grounded and focused. And so, you know, we really want to use the opportunity to borrow from Lincoln Sugar Miner to bring a reminder and an inspiration for that immortal message. Never give up, and certainly never give Jah up. It's a very beautiful song, beautifully delivered. The vocals, the vocal styling, the rhythm, the whole energy is very pleasant to the ears as well.
Here we go with Never Gonna Give Jah Up, Sugar Miner.
Oh no, I'm never gonna give Jah up. No matter what they do, I'm never gonna give Jah up. What they say, oh no, oh no, oh no, oh. You can have the whole world, but give me Jah Jah, but give me Jah Jah. You can have the whole wide world, but give me Jah Jah, but give me Jah Jah. You can have the silver and gold, you can have the rubies and the diamonds, you can have all those pretty girls in this world, wide world, but I never gonna give Jah up. No matter what they do, I never gonna give Jah up. No matter what they
say, oh no, oh no, oh no, oh. Jaja got the whole world in his hands, in his hands. My papa got the whole wide world in his hands, in his hands. I tell you, he's got the rich and the poor. I know he's got the young and the old. So what's the use in seeking vanity and lose your soul? I'm never gonna give you up. No matter what they do, I'm never gonna give you up.
Now, with the last selection that we heard in mind, can you tell us more about the genesis of Rastafari for you, its evolution for you, and what it means to you?
Okay, an interesting question. What happened is that while I was at the St. Elizabeth Technical High School steps, I was in a, you know, it was a technical high school, evidently. So, you know, I studied like engineering, more mechanical engineering, how to make jewelers, voice, water, sprinkler. We were a part of the group that ultimately resulted in a cassava mill that the school won, that impacted national policy. And they developed a cassava factory at Goshen in St. Elizabeth. So while we were there, though, I chose to do sociology as an option. And sociology teaches that the basic unit of any human existence is the individual. And by expansion, the basic social unit is the family. And a family comprises father, mother, and child, or children. And in earth as in heaven, so above, so below, so within, so without. So we would have seen the connection with sun, moon, and star. Chemistry, protons, neutrons, and electrons, even past, present, and future, solid, liquid, and gas, the concept of the triune or the trinity. And so that kind of somehow inspired me while reading the Bible and listening to the music and reading that, you know, it's important to find the father and mother for humanity, which led us to His Imperial Majesty Emperor Haile Selassie I and Empress Menen, the Queen of Queens. And so we see them as the Almighty manifested in the fictional personality. We see them as the father and mother for humanity and aeration. And so interestingly, sociology is kind of what helped me to assimilate the fundamental tenets and concepts and precepts and theological construction of Rastafari. And so, you know, both from an inspirational perspective and from science and education and theology and religion and history and world affairs, filtered the essence which informed and inspired what Rastafari is. And for me, Rastafari is really the totality of what is really. And in the context of the transatlantic triangle, Rastafari represents the resurrection, the renewal. So Rastafari in that sense would have been the only authentic and holistic and indigenous response to the crucifixion and the genocide of slavery and colonialism. And so therefore we are the children of the black resurrection, the plural Christ, Joseph. And our duty is really to breed new thoughts, new values, new hope, new perspectives into the temple of the family of humanity. So Rastafari represents all that and more to I and I still. So in a sense, we would be the plural rendition of Haile Selassie I. And what I mean by that, there was a concept I call eponism, which people can acquaint themselves with. But a similar example would have been just like how Christ said in the Bible, how do you see me hungry and naked and didn't feed me, didn't clothe me? And the people said, no, we didn't see you do that. And he's like, what did Lisa do to these? They do to me. So he's suggesting again that he's the singularity of that plurality. And so just as what I'm trying to say now, we are the plural rendition of His Imperial Majesty Emperor Haile Selassie I. And so certainly we see him as the father for the family of humanity. And so we are the stars in earth, the children of the family of humanity, the children of His Imperial Majesty Emperor Haile Selassie I and of Empress Menen.
Can you tell us more about, so you kind of touched on it earlier about Garnet Silk, but can you tell us more about your experiences in the music world, your writings with music, collaborating, touring? Can you give us a little insight into that part of your life?
Right. Yes, when I was at the St. Elizabeth Technical High School, we used to hang out with the band and the musicians, and we got that first kind of experience. Our style was more of a DJ style. Didn't quite like being a DJ, though. And so when I was at CAST, we had a band called In CAST Bubblers. So those were student bands, and I used to hang out with them and chant with them. I remember chanting one of my poems on Bonnie Wheeler's rhythm, Rock and Groove. Oh, God, I just transitioned recently. So that really kind of pulled me in, like, and as this the person responsible for social and cultural activities on campus, we used to promote events. I remember Ras Karby, High Times with Earl Chinna Simit. Squidley was the drummer, and they played for the Melody Makers as well as the bassist that plays with Squidley, Danny Bassey, as well. We met Danny Axman, that played with the Salomonic Registra. And so those were formative years, which kind of whipped my foot, so to speak, in the industry. And so one of my students on campus, he won some money. I was very helpful to him on campus. So he decided to produce one of my first songs, which turned out to have been Feel Like Crying. And then in those early days, in the late 80s, I met Garnet Silk. He was introduced to me by Tony River. This was in Mandeville, and he started asking about Christ and Rastafari and wanting my perspective as a senior, certainly to him, member of the Rastafari family. And so we developed a nice bond and a nice chemistry and a love and admiration for each other's work and so on. And so we fast forward just a little bit. In the very early 90s, it could have been about 1990-91, thereabout, we were asked by Court Nicole of Roof International to record at Grove Broadcasting, which studio, which is where IFM is at in Notorious. And he was, you know, supposed to have been recording his own song. I recorded my own song. But him called me Isos affectionately most of the time. So he said, Isos, you can't leave the studio today and me and I do a song together. Then I didn't really envision doing any song with anybody, but, you know, we are mutual admirers of each other's work. And so once he said, want a combination, he'll go get a combination kind of a thing. And so they played the hip-hop soap rhythm, and he started to sing Johnny Nash's lyrics, I can see clearly. And he said, hold on, say that again. So we kind of just regurgitated and listened to what he was saying through Johnny Nash's song. And impulsively and intuitively, me just say, wash your troubles, wash them all away. And that was the birth of I Can See Clearly. But we started the Christian Soldiers movement now, so we started doing dances across Jamaica and started recording prolific until I was invited by Ducky Simpson of Black Uhuru to check the rehearsal, and from then they decided to do some recordings with me and to bring me on tour with them. So my very first tour was started in Hawaii, actually. And we did 32 states in America, and then we did 12 countries in Europe. We did Brazil in South America. We did the Caribbean. We did some spot dates both in America as well. And we did Europe another time, and we did some stuff in Jamaica. So those were some early experiences. And then on the 23rd of February 1993, they had the Jammy Awards at the Pegasus Hotel in Kingston, and I was nominated for the previous year, 1992. And Muta Baruka actually was nominated as well, but he won the award, and he went up on stage and called me up. I was reluctant to go, but I finally went, and he said, I am more deserving of this award than him. So he handed it to me. Again, I was reluctant to take it until, you know, there was a kind of a standoff kind of thing. He was really determined for me to take it. I was determined not to. And so something just clicked inside my head. I said, people, we in a democratic country, we're seeking a consensus. What should I do? Oliver Samuels was at the front of the audience. He was the loudest first voice that said, take it. And I said, well, the voice of the people is the voice of God, so thank you. And I took it, and we got a standing ovation. That really brought me to full national attention and beyond as well, because that was live on TV and radio. And it was, you know, a headline news article for an extended period of time, the talk shows, the newspapers, the TV stations, and whatever. So it was kind of a good, and the timing was good also, because it kind of set up a good platform for the work that I did with Dr. Who and the tours. And so, you know, there are many others really, but those are kind of very pivotal and fundamental. And so we started building from that experience as well.
So I know this is probably going to be a difficult question to answer. Out of all those tours that you've done, which are your top three favourites?
Yeah, I'm almost like asking me to name my favourite children, but I'll try. For what Ethiopia means to us as Africans in the diaspora, for Rastafari. And so my tour of Ethiopia in 1996 would have been one. Yes, that would have been one for the sentiments and for Ethiopia being Ethiopia. We were invited to commemorate the bicentenary of the Battle of Adowa. You know, the Adowa was battle, was it, hold on, is the centenary of the Battle of Adowa. Adowa was in 1896 and this was in 1996. Mutabaruka, Kabuma, Hadkeru, Utan, Green, Tono Rebel, and a few others were there from Jamaica. Seymour McLean, is it McLean? The notorious Seymour from London was there. He was the one who repatriated the books from some secret libraries and was investigated by Scotland Yard. Yeah, that same Seymour. He was there and instrumental and that tour as well. And then the experiences that we had in Ethiopia, too much to for the scope of this program, I would think. But I had to make that tour stand out. Let me give you one quick example. His Majesty got a mattress from Sealy Mattress Company when he was in Jamaica in 1966. And it was in one of his palaces in Wandokinet. And we stayed in one of his palaces at Wandokinet, not far from Shashamane. And the lot fall on me, the mantle fall on me to have slept in his bedroom. And after a while, I found out, slept on that mattress that he got from Sealy Mattress Company in Jamaica. So, not just the musical and cultural experiences, but the personal and historical and spiritual experiences had to make that memorable. Inevitably, though, that first tour with Black Uhuru, starting with Hawaii, for the very first time touring, my second time leaving Jamaica, would have been extremely memorable as well. So in terms of the third, maybe I would say the world tour of Overstanding Rastafari, Jamaica's Gift to the World, because that book opened some doors for me that music didn't, and some very significant doors that continue to remain open as well, and brought me to places that I never quite figured the book could have, and to foster sustaining synergies and impact people at a certain level, both academic, cultural, intellectual, spiritual levels as well. So that was three, seem to be the top three for the reasons given.
So your next selection is Spiritual Healing, Toots and the Maytals. Why did you choose this selection?
First of all, you can't escape Toots in Jamaica. He's like the man responsible for the soundtrack as an aspect of the liberation. Not very profoundly, overly Rastafari, but like nigger spiritualist, spiritualist kind of energy that most people can identify with. And so he had that early influence on us. And then when we met him, I met him at Big Sheep Recording Studio when we were doing some work with Freddie McGregor. And I can't forget that the first encounter with Toots, actually. He stopped the session and prayed for me and make some very spiritual, moving pronouncements, which humbled me, really, because I really look up to him as one of the greatest icons from the rock. And so he looked at me as being a special son or something. So me really feel that and draw me close to Toots, really. And then, you know, we maybe use the occasion to share that we do, maybe, how much is it now? We do two songs with Toots and the Maytals. One is called Light Your Light, and the other is called Rasmus Earth Day. And so, you know, getting closer to Toots and his music, because I'm about spiritual healing, because we are spiritual beings having physical experiences, not the other way around. So for that kind of philosophical standpoint and reason, we spiritual healing resonated as we think that's the antidote, actually, that the world needs then and even now and will always. And then that song is, well, the master himself at work right here, Toots and the Maytals. The lyrics, the vocal styling, the music, that is one of my all-time favorite songs, reggae or not. And Toots is one of my all-time favorite artists. So the two, you know, combined, that is one of my penultimate Toots. And Toots is one of my penultimate people. And so I could miss the opportunity, especially in this pandemic. Some people say plandemic, fiendemic, which epidemic it is, we in a crisis. And so the fourth industrial revolution, even a whole global reset. And so spiritual healing, I think, is timely and potent and instructive in that context.
Here we go with spiritual healing, Toots and the Maytals.
What the world needs today, I think spiritual healing. And everyone's gotta say, it gives a good feeling. Spiritual healing, so good, it gives a higher feeling. Ooh, yeah. Spiritual healing, so good. So
events that you produce?
I will eat. And it's not a controversial program, but this might be controversial because many people don't know it. That's the only reason. But I produced Ghana's Silk Birthday Bash, the very first one, in April 2nd, 1993. The following year, well, actually, the first three Rebel Salute, I'm responsible for those, both the name, the concept, in no meat, no alcohol, the whole 9 yards. Most of the people, if not all, actually all except myself, at the time, were meat eaters. Kentucky evil, goat tribe, goat head, liquor, and the whole thing. So that provides some evidence for who would want to investigate that. And so, you know, what under the bridge kind of a thing. We won't go too deep into that. But certainly many others, including Yasus Afari and friends, touring across Jamaica, Edutainment concert series, which we alluded to earlier, as it relates to the Cultural Agency Program with the Ministry of Education in Jamaica, as well as Fathers of Africa tour with Deli Mande and Pablo Moses. But the more abiding ones would have been Poetry in Motion, which started on February 29, 2004. So it is now in its 19th year. And the longest running and most successful annual poetry event in the history of Jamaica. Also, we are responsible, which is my event. Yeah, another abiding event that we have produced and continue to produce is Jamaica Poetry Festival, which is in its 11th annual staging this year, Sunday, August 8th, 2021. And it was one of the first virtual events for 2020. And last year for the 10th anniversary, when people were asking if I'm going to postpone or cancel, I said, no retreat, no surrender. We never give poetry up, just like how Sugar My Lad said, never give Jah up, because we see poetry as an instrument of Jah. And so we just step it up a notch and invited poets from 10 countries, inclusive of Iran, South Korea, Botswana, Netherlands, England, Canada, USA, Trinidad, Barbados, and Jamaica. And so it was the first, one of the first, very first virtual events in Jamaica. We held it at TVJ Studio. TVJ is a popular national television station that belongs to the RGR, Cleaner Communication Group. And so that's quite significant. And this, we are currently negotiating and planning. We have booked Linton Kwesi Johnson for that event. So, you know, that shows you where we are at. And we're talking to a global icon. We won't give away too much on that as yet. But we have Ernie Ranklin will be presented there as a guest artist. Dr. Velma Pola will be our Lifetime Achievement Awardee. We instituted that 5 years ago. And so that's one. The Pomedy Show, which is, you know, a kind of an eclectic mix of poetry and comedy. We have toured the UK with that, even performing with Benjamin Zephaniah on that event at the Broadway Theatre in London, as well as doing Wales and Huddersfield up north, Birmingham, Toronto, right across Jamaica, Montego Bay, Kingston at the University of Technology, among many others. We had not really made that into an annual event, and so we are shaping up to do that now, to at least have one consistently staged at a particular location, to make that a threesome. So you can look out for that. There are a few others that we have, you know, done from time to time, but they have not been as abiding as some of the ones that I've just alluded to.
So we're going to move on to another one of your selections. Again, this is going to, like you said earlier about the obvious reasoning behind it, but I'm going to ask you anyway. So it is I Love King Selassie by Black Uhuru.
Well, again, too, that kind of feed two sets of bird with one feeding. We don't intend killing the bird with a stone. So, you know, I mean, obviously, the role that Black Uhuru played in reggae music and dancehall, for the kind of rude boy energy that Jamaica is good for, but bring it in a positive, constructive, Rastafari, militant, stepping way. You know, Black Uhuru have the title and the mantle there. So, because we grew up on Black Uhuru and we're so honored when we heard that they were talking about me behind the back, saying very good things, until they reached out and invited me to come and link with them and so on. And so, you know, they have so many songs that really, you know, general solidarity and shine eye. And but because we love His Majesty so much, and because of the role that reggae plays in Rastafari and that they played in my life, the things just come together. And one of my favorite Black Uhuru, as one of my favorite groups. And so we took this opportunity and the Reggae Uprising to share and to testify and to say thank you to Black Uhuru, and as well to remind people that the love of His Imperial Majesty is penultimate, certainly for Rastafari. And we see it as a source of redemption for Africa, Africa diaspora, and by extension for humanity. So here we go. I love King Selassie.
I love King Selassie.
unfortunately, we are coming to the end of the interview, but I couldn't just leave it, as this is kind of like a moment in time. All of the interviews are a moment in time, and they're kind of part of our archive of our own stories. I wanted you to give us an insight into your experience of last year and this year and the impact of COVID on maybe you and Jamaica, because obviously in different countries, people's experiences are different. So could you give listeners that maybe aren't from Jamaica an insight into what it's been like in Jamaica, what the impact of COVID has been and your perceptions of how it's affected people there?
Wow. Well, I don't want to go back too deep still, but you know, there's some cool friend, we say. I had this kind of notion, insight about the future from I was a cast some decades ago, which somehow this came back to fore and resonated with me last year, a little before, because I built a tabernacle in the hills, started spending a lot of time there about 4 years ago, started to set up a farm, wanting to put in my studio. And so me started to what you would call, use the wrong words, you know, but me started kind of shaping the quarantine vibe that people have now, voluntary quarantine, where you spend enough time by yourself or with your chosen people and family, focusing on purpose and passion and work and how we can make this world a better place. Trying to be agents and custodians of change, positive change, and using the music and the poetry and the examples and the liberty that we are afforded to kind of positively impact people. And then, bam, I toured the UK in Black History Month 2019, predominantly in Wales, where I was doing preparatory work for an anthology that will be out next month. It is called Building Bridges. We did a similar thing at Uplands Junior High in Wolverhampton when I was the poet in residence in the city of Wolverhampton. And so we duplicated that. And so we kind of did some workshops in Clarendon, penance in Clarendon, where the penance, that's named after penance that came from Wales. And so I linked Richard Douglas Pennant. There's a photograph with me and him on the BBC website, who is now the owner for the Pennant estate. And so, you know, we kind of speak and appeal to his conscience. So he's kind of supporting that school, John Austin College. And so we did some workshops there and excavated some poems. And then we did some workshops in Wales, in the Bangor area, Menai Bridge area, Bethesda era, that sort of era, where the penance are, and around that era. And we did some poems, some workshops, and excavated some poems from those range of students. And so that anthology is called Building Bridges, and will be out next month. So that kind of give you kind of the mindset and the conditioning that I had for the 2020. And so we had Poetry in Motion this last Sunday in February last year, which became, again, one of the last public events held in Jamaica for that year, because within 2 weeks, we were on lockdown in March of last year. And so even my workers and family and friends would have said, wow, well, you did prepare for this all along. This is what you were preparing for. Some of the things I would have said to them, you know, I'm going to that now. One-on-one and in group sessions and encouraging them to farm and to be prepared and to be proactive and to be open-minded and to be critical in terms of how we analyze world affairs and events and history and moving forward. And so when this now come in, it's almost like, say, give justification to some of my critical thinking and evaluation that I've been sharing with people, both on a broad and as a personal one-to-one level. And so this thing really kind of shift the whole normalcy and expectations of people staying at home, almost like a martial law police state crank up to couple notches kind of situation whereby, you know, Jamaica people love to be, you know, larger than life personality, going out, having fun. Now you have to contain that because there's a pandemic. You want to be responsible. You want to be militant and assertive and critical at the same time. So it's a balancing act. And so I've been trying to, with my platforms, trying to get people to be critical, but to be responsible and to sacrifice some of your personal impulse for the group and trying to navigate a crisis. And so it has been a traumatic experience for some people, many people, losing job, losing work hours, losing salary, having to turn your hand, make fashion and work with what you have, with the limitations that you have to endure. And so it has been just for the rest of the world, really, but more so specifically for Jamaica. I'm more intimate with that. I've been here for the whole time. It's really challenging. It's but people, as usual, trying to rise to the occasion, looking internally within the culture and the resources and trying to make that work for us and to adjust our mindset for moving forward in this fourth industrial revolution. When there will be a shift in the dynamics of the world, a paradigm shift of significant proportion. And so, boy, if we're still in the middle of that experience, and then coupled with that, we have so many icons, you know, Toots and the Maytals, Von Wheeler, that Hura, the last event that Hura performed on publicly was the Jamaica Poetry Festival at the RJR Group TVJ studio last year, August. So that's kind of hit close to home. Dalton Brownie, internationally as well, really. So that kind of helped add to the trauma and the drama of this COVID pandemic experience. And so, you know, we're still in the midst of it. We don't know what the end game will be. But we're just telling people to be open-minded, to be critical, to be proactive, to do the research, to be responsible, to care and share. It takes a village to raise a child, and we say is community over chaos. So we're trying to encourage people and using this platform as well. So while we keep uprising, we must be responsible, we must keep grounded, and we must chart a responsible course for the future, whereby we all have to find a way to peacefully coexist on a shared planet with a shared history, a shared existence, and a shared future. So all the best where that is concerned, and happy for the opportunity. Thanks for the opportunity. Gratitude is a must. And so all the best in what you are doing, trying to strengthen people, and especially the African diaspora, to be positive, to hold your head up, to never give up, never give up on Jah, never give up on yourself and your purpose, never give up on humanity. Keep it positive, accentuate the positive, and that will overwhelm the negative. Keep focus and make the four of them course. And remember, energy flows where attention goes. So Rastafari, bless it and set it. Give thanks, my sister. Love and honor and prosperity.
Oh, thank you so much, Yasus. It's been an honor to have you on today's show. And I'm sure all of the listeners will agree with me on that. We're going to finish with your final selection, which is Ganja Farmer, Marlon Asher. Can you give us an insight as to why this is the final selection?
You realize, is Johnny Osborne, Truth and Rights, Redeem That?
Mm-hmm.
So that is one of the reasons. That's a very potent, infectious, lovely rhythm. And so Marlon Asher with this kind of feisty, ranking message. Well, if you don't really understand our jargon, that kind of, well, feisty is a word that is known. What kind of in-your-face kind of message, you know, especially in an advent where ganja was not accepted even in Jamaica and the Caribbean the way it is now. And that kind of message on that rhythm. And, you know, fairly young to me at the time of hearing that song, the Smile and Asha from Trinidad, we kind of like that. And, well, come to think of it, he's only non-Jamaican that I've chosen. So it speaks for itself. But the kind of message and it allows that Caribbean connection and reciprocating the respect and the love in the Caribbean with a sort of inner your face message and a brilliant rhythm. The rhythm and which one of my favorite songs and my favorite artists perform on. So it just come right together. It is maybe only fitting as well. that it is the final selection in this in this out of you. And so full joy, the message in the music and the music in the message. Marlon Asha, Ganja Farmer, straight.
Well, thank you so much. It's been an honor, like I said earlier, to have you on the show. I hope, like, well, this show is only an hour, unfortunately. I think we've run over well over the hour, but I'm hoping that we can get you back for one of the specials to talk more specifically and have a little bit more time. But I appreciate your time so, so much.
Well, yes, sister, certainly you're most welcome. And it is my turn to say how honored and thankful I am for the opportunity to create this synergy and to create this alchemy, which we hope will continue to inspire you and your audience, your listeners. That's what we are about, holding hands together as members of the human family, marching confidently and triumphantly into the ancient immortal future. So take care of yourselves, stay gorgeous, royal and sweet, and Rastafari, bless it and set it. Give thanks.
Oh, he said it so much better than me, but I'm going to say goodbye as well. I hope you have a wonderful week. Make sure you come straight back here next Wednesday for a fresh and new episode. I'm going to leave you with the sounds of Marlon Asha, Ganja Farmer. As always, blessed love.
I'm a ganja planter, call me the ganja farmer. Deep down in the earth, we may put the ganja. Babylon, come and light it at a fire, me a chant. Yes, I'm a ganja planter, call me the ganja farmer. Deep down in the earth, we may put the ganja. Babylon, come. Big stinking helicopter flow through the air. With them call it weed eater. Them never did it when me was out in water, or when me did them blind fertilizer. Yet out of the sky them spitting fire, and I'm a little youth man with a hot temper. Me dig up me stinking rocket launcher, and in all the air this buzz the helicopter me a chant. Some ganja planter, call me the ganja farmer. Deep down in the earth we me put the ganja. Babylon come a lot in a tough fire me a chant. Yes, I'm a ganja planter, call me the ganja farmer. Deep down in the earth we me put the ganja. Babylon come, yeah, true no man. True Jaja bless I with no for good vibes man. And true me of the yard is set a ganja in a the land. Make doctors get no meditation, and so them coulda give it to them sick patient. Make chemists get no meditation, and so them coulda brew new medication. Make singers get some inspiration, and so them coulda spread your message on the land. Me a chant. Yes, I'm a ganja planter, call me the ganja farmer. Deep down in the earth, we may put the ganja. Babylon, come and light it at a fire, me a chant. Yes, I'm a ganja planter, call me the ganja farmer. Deep down in the earth, we may put the ganja. Babylon, come.